How do you discover the true and real history of a religion, a culture, and a people? Well, you discover the truth by what the historians leave out. And what has the Utah Mormon Church left out about the Nauvoo Joseph Smith history? Simply the fact that there was an insurrection and assassination conspiracy that had been hatched by the Quorum of the Twelve clearly 6 months before Joseph Smith was assassinated. And you can find all this information in the actual documents of the Joseph Smith papers. Yes, some of these documents have been interlineated or lined out to show that they are being eliminated, but the drafts have left certain information in. And one of them is an affidavit sworn by Marinus Eaton on March 14, 1844, claiming that he attended a secret meeting with the elders of Nauvoo, including Robert Foster, the Higbee brothers, Chauncey Higbee, Joseph H. Jackson, a member of the Secret Council of 50, and William and Wilson Law, who had sworn oaths to assassinate Joseph Smith and to cause an insurrection in conspiracy with certain people who lived in Carthage to overthrow the Mormon Church as we know it, headed by Joseph and Hyrum Smith. This is what the Utah Mormon Church has conveniently left out, as well as all the other documents which show a completely different history. So this is from the Joseph Smith papers. I'll leave a link, and I'm going to read from this. We're going to read from Eaton's affidavit sworn in Nauvoo before the Justice of the Peace, Daniel Wells, about the secret plot he uncovered while attending a secret meeting at the store in Nauvoo, in which Joseph Jackson, Robert Foster, the Higbees were all in attendance, and they claimed that Wilson and William Law were also in collusion with him. And these are the expositors, conspirators that were plotting an insurrection to overthrow the city government of Nauvoo. Hancock County, State of Illinois. Personally appearing before me, Daniel H. Wells, an acting Justice of the Peace in and for the County of Hancock, appeared before me, M.G. Eaton, who after being duly sworn, according to the law, deposited and saith that on or about the 15th day of March, 1844, Joseph H. Jackson came to me several times and requested to go into the hill with him, to go on the hill with him. I finally consented and went with him to the Keystone store in the city of Nauvoo. Dr. Foster and one of the Higbees, I think it was Chauncey Higbee, were in the store. The said Joseph H. Jackson, together with R.D. Foster and said Higbee, went into the back of the store. They appeared to enter a private council. Soon after they went into said room, the said Joseph H. Jackson invited me into the room, where they were all sitting. I immediately complied. Soon after I went into the room, said Higbee commenced talking about the spiritual wife system. He said he had no doubt that the elders then, 10 or 12 apiece, he said they had married them together with females who were willing or not, and they said it was recorded, and he said they did it by recording the marriage in a large book, which book was sealed up after the record was made and was not to be opened until a long time. Probably not until many of the husbands of those that were thus married were dead. They would then open the book and break the seals in the presence of those females, and when they saw their names recorded in that book, they would believe that the doctrine was true and that they must submit. He said that this book was kept by Mr. Hyrum Smith. I asked, this said Chauncey Higby. There that follows some expressions too indecent to for insertion. So they're saying that this part was deleted because it was just too indecent. The aforesaid Robert D. Foster then asked me what I would think if during my absence from home, a carriage should drive up to my house, a person alight, and the carriage then drive off again. This person should go into my house and begin to tell my wife a great deal of many things against me, to prejudice her against me, and that every possible means to do this, and finally would introduce and preach the spiritual wife doctrine to her, and make an attempt to seduce her. And further, this person should sit down to dine with my wife, bless the victuals, and while they were thus engaged, I should come home, and then find them associated. This person shall rise up and say, how do you do? And bless me in a very polite manner. And then also, if upon an appearance, I should feel jealous that something was wrong, and when that person was gone, I would ask my wife what had been the conversation between the two of them, but she would refuse and tell me. I then would draw my pistol and present it to her head, and threaten to shoot her if she did not tell me all, but she would refuse, and I would then give her a double-barreled pistol and say to her, defend yourself, for if you don't tell me, either you or I would shoot. She would then faint away through fear and excitement, and when she came to again, she would begin to tell me how this person had been trying to poison your wife's mind against you, and by preaching the high spiritual wife doctrine to her, had endeavored to seduce her. I replied, this is Eaton, I replied that I would think he was a rascal. But who has had such a trial as that? Eaton asked. The said R.D. Foster answered that he was the man who had that trial and who had been thus abused. The said Robert Foster Higby and Joseph H. Jackson then remarked that they were about to hold a secret meeting to oppose and try to put a stop to such thing. The said Joseph H. Jackson also said that if any person undertook to arrest him, he should begin to cut them. And that's cut with a knife. The said Robert D. Foster further said that he was afraid for his life and dare not be out at night. The said Higby said he had not no doubt that there had been men killed in Missouri who had such secrets, and they were afraid they would divulge them. The said Higby then said that he had no doubt that there had been men who had been killed in Missouri who had held such secrets. He's saying that about the Smiths, had held such secrets and who were afraid they would divulge him. He said he was afraid for his life. This is Higby. Higby said he was afraid for his life because of the secrets he held about the Smith brothers. The said Jackson further said that he should not be surprised that there should be a real muss and an insurrection in the city in less than 2 months, and that if a disturbance should take place, the Carthaginians and others would come and help them. This is when they divulged that there is a secret insurrection that was coming in conspiracy with others who lived in Carthage. And this was divulged by Joseph H. Jackson. And Joseph H. Jackson, according to city council minutes, had been an aide to come to Joseph Smith. However, Joseph A. Jackson was not a Mormon, but had been part of the Nauvoo militia. He mentioned, and this is Joseph A. Jackson, mentioned that the names of persons who would come from Carthage, which names I do not remember, The same day when in Mr. Loomis's room, I heard said Jackson say that the laws were ready to enter into a secret conspiracy, tooth and nails. So Joseph A. Jackson just confessed to Eaton that the laws were also involved with the Carthaginian conspiracy for an insurrection in Nauvoo. And this is taking place in March of 1844. Mr. Eaton had sworn out this affidavit under Sheriff Wells or Constable Wells. It continues, the said Higbees also said while the key stone store that said Higbees also said that well at the Keystone store that if he was brought before the mayor's court again and the mayor told him to hold his tongue that he should get up and tell the mayor that he had the right to speak and should do so, and then if any man attempted to put him out of the court he would shoot them through, and further this deponent saith not. And it is signed, the deponent's name is Marinus G. Eaton, sworn and subscribed before March AD 1844. And that's the 27th of March 1844 between, I believe this is Constable or Sheriff Daniel H. Wells. And that is the plot for the insurrection and the eventual assassination of the Smith brothers. This plot, according to Daniel Eaton, this plot, according to Marinus Eaton, included the Fosters, the Higbees, and the Wilson and William Laws. And this is in March of 1844. The Smith brothers were assassinated June 27th, 1844. So 3 months in advance time, the Smith brothers knew of this insurrection that was being planned between the Carthage conspirators and the Nauvoo conspirators, which included these Expositors newspaper. Now, have you ever heard that? Have you ever heard that the conspirators who owned the Expositor newspaper were in secret combination to assassinate the Smith brothers and cause an insurrection 3 months before Joseph Smith and the city council claimed that the Expositor was a nuisance? Well, of course the Expositor was a nuisance because it was planning a violent insurrection. So this is part of the trial against Robert Foster, Chauncey, and Joseph H. Jackson, William and Wilson Law. President Joseph Smith addressed the people. The following is the substance of what I heard him say. I have been informed by two gentlemen that a conspiracy exists in Nauvoo. It's got up in a place of purpose of taking the life of President Joseph Smith and his family, and all the Smith family and the heads of the church. One of the gentlemen will give his name to the public, and the other wishes to be hid at present. They will both testify to it in oath and make an affidavit upon it. The names of the persons revealed at the head of this conspiracy are as follows: Chauncey Higbee, Dr. Robert D. Foster, and Joseph F. Jackson, William Law, and William Wilson Law. And the lies that Chauncey Higbee has hatched up a foundation of work upon are, he says that I had men's heads cut off in Missouri. This is Joseph Smith speaking. That Higbee said he had heads cut off of men in Missouri, and I'd run them through the sword of, I'd run a sword, and that I had a sword run through the hearts of people that I wanted to kill and put out of the way. I won't swear out a warrant against them, for I don't fear any of them. They would not care, they would not scare off an old sitting hen. I intend to publish all of their iniquity that I know of them. If I am guilty, I am ready to bear it. There is sometimes honor among enemies. I am willing to do anything for the good of the people. I will give the name of the one of the gentlemen who has divulged the plot. His name is Marinus G. Eaton. He will swear to it. He is a bold fellow. Joseph H. Jackson said Smith should not be alive in 2 months' time. That is Joseph Smith. Will not be alive in 2 months' time. In 2 weeks, not over 2 months now. Concerning the character of these men, I will say nothing about it now. But I hear anything more from them on this subject, I will tell you what I know.